Alleluia, Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter addressed the people, "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what we had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sin, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I, myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I can't stand watching a movie, a TV show, or reading a book whose ending I can figure out within the first 5 minutes. I like surprises. That's why reading the Bible is so much fun. No one would have ever predicted the outcomes we read about in the Gospels after reading Genesis. The Bible might have the greatest holy cow moment in all literature, and the whole thing hangs on these questions. Who is the Messiah? And who is going to fix this mess that we found ourselves in? Today's gospel lesson comes right after the Emmaus Road interaction. If you remember that story, Cleopas and another disciple of Jesus were walking to Emmaus from Jerusalem, and Jesus appeared to them as they walked, but they didn't recognize him. So they told Jesus about the events of his own death. And Luke tells us that Jesus, on this walk, interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Immediately following the Emmaus story, Jesus appeared to them again and again. Luke tells us Jesus opened their minds to understand the scriptures. What Jesus said to them opened up the Old Testament so that they understood who Jesus is and who their Messiah is. The message changed their perspective and enabled the apostles to begin the church. What did the word Messiah mean for a first century Jew, and what did Jesus teach the apostles in his resurrection appearances that introduced them to a new understanding of Messiah? Messiah literally means anointed one. There are numerous messianic figures in the Old Testament, King David being the most obvious one. And David was indeed anointed by God and with the Holy Spirit. David was, for a first century Jew, the definitive Messiah. However, there are many other messianic figures throughout the Old Testament: Abraham, Melchizedek, Moses, Deborah, Barak, and Ruth are all messianic figures. They all do their part to protect and to save Israel, and they were all anointed by God for something special. The apostles expected Jesus to be more like these Old Testament messianic figures. After all, Jesus was anointed in his baptism by the Holy Spirit, and he was sent from God. Reading the Bible backwards can reveal what Jesus taught his disciples and how he opened the scriptures to them. What I mean by that is that we must read the Old Testament through the lens of Jesus Christ and what we know about him. Richard Hayes's book, Reading Backwards, does just this. And he makes the case that Luke uses three verses in his gospel from Isaiah and his interpretation to reveal who the Messiah really is. Now, each one of these verses from the prophet Isaiah begins with this. Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Isaiah rightfully names not people as the Redeemer, but God himself. Isaiah promises that God is the Redeemer of Israel. What Jesus reveals to his disciples in his resurrection appearances in Luke must have been that while God has anointed messianic figures throughout history from Abraham on, those who he anointed were not the ones who were saving Israel. The whole time, it was the Word of God himself, through whom all creation was made, who is also to redeem his creation. His saving deeds are shown in the Old Testament, but who he is revealed in Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Redeemer. The true Messiah of Israel, of the world, isn't a man or a woman whom God anoints. The Messiah is the very Word of God himself, Jesus. If we go back and reread all the heroic stories of the Old Testament, what we realize, what Isaiah tells us, and what Jesus shows us is that God himself is the Redeemer. The messianic figures like Abraham, Melchizedek, Moses, Deborah, Barak, Ruth, and David are the mouthpiece or the catalyst that God uses for his saving actions. It's not those individuals who are saving Israel. It's God. The Messiah cannot simply be a man. He must be the incarnate Word of God. This truth, revealed to the apostles by Jesus in the power of the Holy Spirit, set the world on fire and establishes Christ's bride, the church, of which we are all members. If we want to know our Redeemer better, we must do all we can to steep ourselves in Scripture. Reading Scripture is the most intimate way to get to know God. It is the record of all of his redeeming acts. Reading Scripture helps us see how God is the author of our redemption and how God has acted throughout history. All this talk about redeeming and redemption. Redemption has two definitions, a theological definition and a secular one. The theological definition is the action of saving or being saved from sin, error, or evil. The secular definition is the action of regaining or gaining possession of something in exchange for payment or clearing a debt. Both definitions apply to Jesus. We are his. We're not our own. Jesus' life, death, and resurrection clear humanity's debt. Good way of putting it, so we can all understand, is that Christians are the ultimate trust fund babies. The owner of our trust is God himself, Jesus, our Messiah. We cannot incur a debt too large that he, when asked, cannot or will not repay. It's up to us to ask, however, and to thank him for the payment he continually offers on our behalf. Jesus offers that payment with only one term: that we love him. That we love him. Loving Jesus means we want to maintain a relationship with him by praying, by reading scripture, by being in church every Sunday, and by loving our neighbor. Contemplate redemption today. Consider the one who created you is also the one who has redeemed you. I believe that realization makes this Easter season even more sweet than it already was. And it makes all the alleluias that we sing throughout this season even more glorious. Alleluia.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of his Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. We pray for Lee and David, for those in the hospital, those in hospice, for the recent faithful departed, especially Gloria Goldsmith and Michael Sunich, and Virginia Brown, in whose memory the sanctuary candlelight is given today.
Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Please be seated. Good morning and welcome to St. John's Church on the third Sunday of Easter. It is great to see you all here today, and if you are visiting with us, it's our great pleasure that you're here, and we hope that you will make St. John's your parish home. A few announcements today. Adult confirmation classes conclude today in the rector's office. Next Sunday, the bishop will be here for our confirmation service, so make sure you're all on your best behavior next Sunday. If you've been attending St. John's for less than a year, you're invited to join us in the Lowry Room after the 9:30 service today. These sessions will introduce you to many wonderful ministries available and teach you how you might like to become involved here at St. John's. It's also time to register for the St. Michael's Conference, the youth conference, youth age 9th grade to 21 years old. I'll be going this year, and I'm bringing quite a few kids, and I'm hoping more will join me. So if you're interested in the St. Michael's Conference, please contact me. Details are in your bulletin. The Sisters Spring Tea will be on Saturday, April 27th from 11:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. See
your bulletin for details. Now, I said last week adults were going to play kids in kickball, and some of you snickered at me as if we weren't going to win. The parents beat the youth in kickball last week 17-4. And no mercy was extended to the children. Hope's Nehemiah action takes place this Tuesday. All the details about that are in your bulletin. If you want more information on that, you could also talk to Laura Cruz after church today. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings.
Thank you.
up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, with John our patron, and all your saints, into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with the spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.